Hey, you guys. Hi, and happy Friday. I'm so excited to be in here answering questions you've got about farm marketing, business, whatever it is you wanted to ask as a new-ish farmer. I've got your answers today. We had so many wonderful questions come in, and you can also ask more here in the comments. I will totally take care of answering those. And anyway, let me know who's here. I would love to know who's here and what's the weather doing where you are. It is the most gorgeous fall day here in Oregon. And if I could turn the camera around, it's our leaves are incredible, gold and yellow and red, and there's a little fog and it's beautiful. So, good, Michelle. I have answers to your questions on here too. So I'm really glad you're here live. Where do you live, Michelle? I would love to know where you guys are coming in from too. Let's see, Michelle. I think your question is like the fifth question down. So I am really glad to have you here live. Everyone, please know that the replay sits here forever, forever, forever. If you have to leave early, it will be here. It's also, I'm going to move all the content to the podcast, and that'll be released in a while, maybe like 4 weeks or so, because we've got some things queued up before then. But thank you for being here. I'm going to dive in. And again, those of you watching, if you want to ask questions live too, you can definitely do that. We got a ton of questions. So I'm going to dive in. And let's see, I'm going to put my notes in front of me so that I can still see your questions too. Christina says, Tennessee, sunny and 59. Yeah, you know, we're in Oregon, sunny and going to be 68 today, which is so unusually warm. Oh, Michelle, you're in Zealand. Wonderful. I don't know where Zealand is. I think I may have heard of that, but I'm not sure which part of Michigan. I'm flying out to Chicago on Monday, and I'm so excited that I'm going to meet people from this group. I'm doing an all-day workshop next Tuesday, the 29th. And I get to meet several of you. I've heard, got even more emails this morning. Oh man, you're going to learn a ton. My all-day workshops are so intense and full, and you learn stuff because I have you actually do it. It's going to be really, really cool. One of the biggest things I do that blows people away is I bring up a random ideal customer and I interview them. I've never met them before. And people are blown away at the reasons they buy from the farm. And it has nothing to do with what we farmers think is the reason they are buying. So that blows people away. That is in my all-day workshops that I teach when I travel. So if you can ever make it to one of those, I notice that the prices, because they get grants to bring me in, so they keep the price low. It's like the cheapest thing in the world to get a year's worth of marketing content and tons of training. So, can't wait for those of you I'm going to see there. And Serena, I'm so glad you're here from Missouri. 25 inches, did you say? Or maybe you said a quarter inch. Maybe that's a quarter inch of a drizzle. Yeah, I know. The drizzle makes you wet and it's not even like really rain. So, you guys, anyway, our weather here is so gorgeous. I'm gonna ride my horse this afternoon. Like it's been too cold and rainy to ride, but why not? 68 degrees. So let me jump into the questions. And isn't this guy in my background cute? That is my big boy, Gray Feather. I love him. My cats, because I keep my office warm while the rest of the house is cold, because I don't want to spend money heating it up when no one's out there. All the cats come in my office while I work all day long, and it's really fun. I'll send my husband pictures of me surrounded by cats while I'm working, so he's there in the background. Okay, let's get on with questions. I have been chatting long enough. So, the first question to be posted is actually one that several people asked in different ways. So, I think it's about the most popular question you guys have. How to find customers, right? How to find customers. So, I'm going to talk to you about this, but Jen Evans asked first, and Kendra McCorkadale had a very similar question, and about three other people had similar questions. So, let me talk to you about that. Jen's question is, she lives in a small farming town where you either raise cows or grow crops. I want a farm stand, but I'm worried that living in a farm town, it won't have a huge turnout selling my meat. A farm down the way has a small milk shed with milk and hamburger, and they struggle. What do I think? Here is what I know absolutely for a fact. It's not even opinion. You can 100% make your farm store successful no matter where you live. I live an hour from the nearest city, and people drive an hour out to buy from us, and I live just in an area like you. I live in a town of 400 people, and they all raise conventional Roundup sprayed wheat or some big, huge fields of hops that go to Coors, not even microbrewers. They're conventional farmers. And here's my little farm stand here. And we do, you know, $250,000 of business out of this little 8 by 10 foot store. So you can absolutely do it, but you've got to learn how to do it. And same with your neighbor's shed with milk and hamburger. They could be selling so much out of their store. So the first mistake that they're making, and I don't want you to make, is to build your farm stand and think that people are going to come buy from you. That's not how it works. People don't know you exist, and they don't want to stop in a roadside stand. That's inconvenient. They're usually on the way to somewhere else. And, you know, it looks nice, but they don't even really know if you take checks, or they feel like they're invading your space, so they don't want to stop in and ask. So if you build a farm stand and you expect it to attract customers just because you built it, that will not work. You will fail. You will lose money. Okay. And if you think, wow, she's so opinionated about that, I work with hundreds of farmers a year, and I have my own experience for 10 years. You have to learn to bring people to your farm stand. Chances are it may not be your local community, but it may. My customers all came from an hour away, and it wasn't until, and all the local conventional farmers thought it was really cute. Like, oh, look at that cute Charlotte. She's got her little cute little roadside stand. They have no idea that I have $250,000 coming into that farm store every single year, and they can barely scrape by on their conventional farms. You know, so I'm telling you, it is absolutely possible, but you've got to learn the marketing steps to bring people there. You create your email list. You get email marketing software. You create at least a one-page landing page website that can be free through MailChimp. So you do that, and then you have to get out in your community and meet people and invite them to your email list. You email them once a month, minimum year round. Your email is all about the things they want to hear about, and they will love you, and they can't wait to drive an hour out of their way to come to your farm stand and buy lots of stuff. They don't even care what you sell when you do this. What you're doing is you're learning to build a relationship with them. So this is so important that you learn this. Otherwise, you will go out of business very quickly. The average farmer goes out of business. The average business goes out of business within 2 years, okay? 98% chance of going out of business within 2 years. So I want you to have a sense of urgency about learning how to bring customers to your business. And that was such a popular question when I posted this. So that's what you're going to do, Jen. You're going to start your email list. And yeah, Marlene, the recording, the live video stay on Facebook forever. And I have an answer to your question, Marlene. You were one of the people that asked a question, so that's coming up too. So do listen to the recording if you can't stay for the whole thing, because this is going to be a long video. I got a ton of questions. I'm going to put it on. It'll stay here. It'll also be on YouTube, and it'll be on the podcast in a month or so. So Jen, those are the steps you take. If you have not heard of Farm Marketing from the Heart, that course teaches you step-by-step how to do all the things I just described. I know of no other place where you can get that how-to laid out for you. It takes about 6 weeks to learn all that. So I've told you what, here in this video, I've given you a taste of what you need to learn to bring people there and why you need to do it. And then you need to set aside some time to invest in learning the how-to, and you will have a very, very, very busy farm stand, okay? We've got 20 people a day that would drive out to our farm store 5 days a week, so much so that we switched it to 4 days a week, and it's manned all the time. I've talked about that elsewhere, that if you have a self-serve farm store, you won't sell nearly as much, and people are afraid to stop in. They feel like they're bugging you. You got to make it easy on them. You got to have someone there to greet them, and they buy a lot more stuff, probably 2 to 3 times as much stuff. They make 2 to 3 times the purchases when someone is there. So it's totally worth having someone at your farm stand running it. So there you go, Jen. You can absolutely be really successful, and so can your neighbor with hamburger and milk. And if you sell something different than hamburger and milk, you guys can help together. Bring them into this group too, so they can learn what they need to do, why they need to do it, and you guys can study together, because the more customers you can get out to your area, the better. And it might be some of your local community buying from you, but it might take them a little while to warm up to them. Okay, so Kendra McCorkadale asked a very similar question. We have a strawberry farm planted this year, first harvest next spring. We want to offer you pick and ready pick at a mostly manned but sometimes cash box farm stand. What's the best way, aside from Facebook contests and postings, to spread the word and get customers? We will be attending our local market during our season too. Best way to get customers, you've got to get out off the farm, get out in your community, tell people what you do, how you help them, and get them on your email list. And again, I teach you step by step how to do that. If you haven't taken my free email marketing training, start with that. But invest. It is the best business sense to start a business and then learn how to market it, or learn how to market it and then start your business. That's ideal. Learn how to do the marketing first, because it is an investment. You're going to spend some months learning how and what to do and getting it set up. If you've already started your business, and Kendra, you say your first berries will be ready in the spring, start now learning how to market it step by step. You'll spend, you know, probably 100 hours learning how to do that between now and spring. And what will happen is you will be sold out from the get-go, and you will be able to charge the price you need to charge with a 50% profit margin. What most people do is they use pricing as their marketing. They want to get customers because they have the so-called best price. Well, that's a fast track to going broke, because as you all know, there's very low profit margins. You've got to get your prices up there. If you're going to be successful, you've got to probably be the highest priced person in your area. And you do that by learning how to market it ahead of time, create that buzz so that you've got a group of customers ready and waiting to pay your price no matter what it is, because they trust you tremendously. So that's what you're going to do, Kendra. Learn how to get your marketing set up. Take a couple months to get everything in place, your website, your email marketing list, your freebie that you're going to give away, and then go out in your community and meet people. Facebook contests, you get people who want to win the prize, but they aren't interested in buying your product. So Facebook contests are not a good way, and Facebook posts are not a good way. So you've got your email marketing and your website are the foundation of your marketing, and Facebook will not work unless that foundation is set up. So again, Kendra, since you have your product coming in spring, you've got to take the next couple of months to learn this in great detail and start practicing it, get it in place so that you can hit the ground running and not lose a ton of money. Because I see so many farmers lose a lot of money and go out of business. And the thing is, they go out of business very quietly. They don't come into this Facebook group and say, you know, you guys, I'm going out of business. We lost, you know, $95,000 since we started 2 years ago. All our kids' college money is gone. So we're shutting down the farm and we're going and getting a job. 98% of farmers are going out of business, and they aren't coming in here and telling us that. They go quietly out of business. So I want to tell you that I have or share you the perspective I have of that, looking in the window of thousands of farmers' businesses, and you've got a limited amount of time to learn how to market your business direct to consumer before it starts costing you too much to stay in business. So spend, you know, we're coming on to winter here in the Northern Hemisphere. So it's a great time to get your marketing in place. And just know Facebook and Instagram won't work to get customers unless you've got your website and email marketing working for you. Okay. So next question is Michelle. And Michelle, I know you were here. Wait, no, this is Michelle Cowie. Different Michelle. She has created her email list using MailChimp. Amen. That's great. Start sending out monthly emails to my current customers, but how do you build that list and find additional customers? Okay, I plan on making a Facebook and Instagram post where people can click to buy my sign up. What are other strategies? So it takes a long, long time to turn a Facebook person on your page or an Instagram person on your account into a paying customer. Long, long, long time. Months, weeks, if you're lucky, months, and maybe even years. When I meet people in person, 99% chance that they will become a buying customer. So Michelle Cowie, I can't emphasize enough how you guys have to get off the farm. You've got to meet people. You've got to share with them how you help. When people buy your product, what happens to them? How are they using your product to improve their lives or reach a goal? That's what you're sharing. Okay. So you've got to get out in public and do that. What that looked like for me is 10 years ago, like now I have a national stage. 10 years ago, my local, one of my customers was in the Rotary Club that meets in our local town of a few hundred people. And they said, "Hey, we're always looking for interesting topics. Will you come tell us what it's like to milk a cow?" And I was like, "Oh, that sounds weird, but guess what?" I thought, okay, if they want to learn what it's like to get up at milk the cow at 5 before the kids get up and then get the kids off to school, I'll go talk to them about that. So I'm in a pizza parlor in a town 5 miles away. They're eating pizza. I'm talking about my farm. Well, you know who are members of Rotary Club, or the people who can take time out of their day to go to a meeting of a volunteer organization that raises money are people, business owners with money to spend. So the very week that I went and talked to these people sitting around eating their round table pizza, I had 10 new customers in my farm store, and they are solid, loyal customers. It wasn't about the money. It wasn't about getting a good deal. It was just people that they met me in person and they're like, "I want to buy from her. I don't even know yet what she sells, but I want to go out there and buy from her." That's what happened. So get out in your community. You got to get off the farm. I had someone join the Facebook group yesterday, and there's a bunch of questions in there you have to answer so that we know you're real and not spam. And this person said, I love to farm. I want to build my profitable farm, but I detest people. He actually used the word detest. And I understand that people get to that point, but if you're gonna sell direct to consumer, you've got to work on your mindset so you don't detest people, because that will come through in your marketing. If I met that person in person, guaranteed I would sense that he detested people and I would not want to buy from him. That would be a big turnoff. So that's an example of, it starts with your mindset of you've got to have the right mindset to sell direct to consumer. And that's a mindset of your, that you are there to serve people. If you detest people, it's going to come through in your marketing. Trust me on that. So Michelle Cowie, get out in person and meet people everywhere you go. Say yes to every invitation you get. Take product with you, whatever it is. And if you sell flowers and it's the middle of winter and you don't have flowers, go to the store and get some flowers so that everywhere you go, you show up with a flower bouquet. Doesn't matter if they're from the store, you are your brand. They are going to know that you're the person that shows up with flowers, no matter if they're from your garden or in the off season, they're from the local grocery store. So That's what you do. And again, because you mentioned Facebook and Instagram, they don't work until you have your foundation of your email list and your website not only created, but actually making money for you. When they're making money, then you know Facebook and Instagram will work. Okay, so Tara and Shane, or Tara, I never know. I have two friends. One is named Tara and one is named Tara. So sorry if I'm mispronouncing it. You're in North Carolina, she says, and you can now do herd shares in North Carolina. Would like to know how we should start this out on the right foot. We already have customers waiting for our kidding season, next kidding season, to produce milk. So I assume you're kidding in a few months, right? So those people have expressed interest now, but they're going to forget about you in a few months. They're not going to know to check back with you. So you've got to keep in touch with them. So make sure that you've got them on your email list, your MailChimp list. These are already people you know have expressed interest. And then you start asking them their interests, so you know what they want to hear from you about. And you start writing emails to them once a month minimum. And you're building that relationship. You're sharing with them things that they want to hear about. So when you finally kid and you have milk, you will be sold out from the start. So that's the most important thing. Those are people who want to buy from you. Get them on your email list now and keep in touch with them until you have something to sell, and you will sell out. And they will tell you what they want to hear from you about. And it's not your farming practices. I want to make sure everyone's clear on that. That will probably bore them, you know, and make it hard to turn them into customers. So just know that they aren't wanting to hear from you about your marketing practices or your farming practices, and they start talking to them. They will tell you what they want to hear about in your emails. All right. So Marley Johnson says, this is a very common question. What is the best day of the week and time to send out emails to get the most people opening them? So there is no definite black and white in marketing. You have to try and test things, and it has to work for your customers, but it has to work for you too. So Monday mornings, I'm very busy. I don't like to send emails on Monday mornings, so I don't. So that's out for me. Fridays are a good day for me because it creates a lot of traffic on Saturday on the farm. So I usually stick to Thursdays and Fridays for my farm, but you want to experiment with what works for you, and know that if you read something on the internet that gives you the exact day and time to send out an email, know that there's no way they could know that. That's wrong. That's misinformation. I get a lot of replies to my emails because I'm writing to people about things I know they want to hear about. So they're writing me back. The sooner I respond to them, the sooner they will buy from me and the more trust I have. So I don't want to send an email on Saturday or Sunday because I try to stay out of my email box on the weekend. So if they write to me, I won't be there to respond back. I'm mostly in my office Tuesday through Friday. So I've chosen one of those days to email. Now, if you notice, my 3-count marketing emails come out on Thursdays. And then our farm emails, Thursday or Friday was always a good day. So try it. Try Marley. Pick a day. Figure out what works for you and try it. And then try it for a couple months and then switch days if you want. Probably you won't notice a big difference. Because I teach you how to have engaged relationships with your customers, they love getting your emails. Most of our marketing students, it doesn't really matter what day of the week they send them. However, a lot of them send them toward the end of the week because of their markets or something like that. So just know that. Try it out. I think in email inboxes, Monday is a busy day in email inboxes. So you might want to avoid Mondays just because a lot of people are they're getting a lot of emails. Black Friday, I'm getting ready. My email is due on Thanksgiving Day, but I don't really want to bug my list on Thanksgiving Day. So I thought the next day, and I thought, well, that's Black Friday. They're going to get 300 emails in their inbox from all the sales. So do I want to compete with that? So figure out what works best for you. test it. Marketing is all about testing, giving it some time to test it. Look at your results with your MailChimp account will tell you exactly how many openings you're getting. And you say time of day. I like to send my emails out in the morning because then I get my responses during the day and I can email people back. So figure out what works for you and what works for your customers and then practice it. Okay, and now Michelle Renee, if you're still here, I hope you are. Let me know if you're here live. And oh, Becky says, when will you have a workshop closer to home? I'm on the Oregon-California border. So all you guys, I don't decide where my workshops are. I have organizations reaching out to me all the time that are bringing me to their organization to speak. So I don't plan them because if I plan them all, it would be like in my backyard. So I didn't have to travel, or I'd love the Oregon-California border. So I'm being requested already for 2021. So Becky Robison, if you have an organization near Oregon-California border, I would love to do it because it's close to home, and have them reach out to me and we can talk about my fees and all of that. But I go where people take me, but I would love it because I sent my schedule out this morning by email for all of those of you on my email list. So the closest I'm going to be is San Diego, California. And then Becky, what do you sell? Would love to know that too. So good question there. And now let's get to Michelle Renee's question. Okay, Michelle says, I'm stuck on writing my first email newsletter and blog post. I have lots of ideas, but I'm stuck on what my first blog post and newsletter should say. Plus, I don't have any great pictures right now, and that's holding me back. Any suggestions? And then Marlene, if you're still here, commented right after that she's just typing the same thing in. She's been collecting email addresses for a while, don't have your website up yet. You do want to start sending out an email every 2 weeks while finishing up your website and starting a blog. I'm not sure how to start the first email. Hi, everyone. And you suggested, Marlene, hi, everyone. Remember that one time when you gave me your email at the farmer's market a few months ago, which of course I won't remember. So I love that you said that there. Marlene and Michelle, both, since it's going to be your first email that you will send to people, what I like to do to remind them that they actually said it was okay to be on the list, if I'm sending a first email after a period where I've not emailed them for whatever reason, I will say something like, thank you so much for being a part of our farm community. Okay. So use some verbiage similar to that, like, hey, and then put their first name in there. So they're going to get an email that says, hey, Marlene, thank you so much for being part of our farm community. They're going to be like, oh, you're welcome. I didn't even know I was, but it feels good to be a part of it. That's what's going to go on in their head. So that's how you started out. Thanks for being a part of our farm community. That also lets them know, it reminds them that they somehow must have signed up to be part of your farm community. And it's very friendly. It would be more formal to say, you're getting this email because you signed up to our email list. That wouldn't be as engaging, right? You guys know that. So just use that word. Oh, good. Michelle is here too. Michelle Renee. And Aaron Simmons is here. Yay, Aaron. Look, Aaron, look at this. Look what sits on my desk right here. I'm going to email you about this. But I have to say, I teach you guys in Sales Made Simple in my courses. I teach you guys to send thank you notes. And Aaron is so good at that. And so I even teach people to send thank you notes. And it feels so amazing to get a thank you note in the mail. And if you are not writing thank you notes to your customers, Aaron Simmons sent me this one. It's so beautiful. I love it. I love it, love it, love it. But I'm going to email you about that too. Becky sells lavender, essential oils, fresh cut flowers, and veggies. Perfect. Perfect. And you're Oregon, California. So I'd love to come down there if you can find someone. And Becky, right above you, Aaron, do you guys know each other? Because Aaron is a flower farmer on Vashon Island. And if Aaron would probably come south for a workshop, if Becky, you would come north for a workshop, because we've talked about me speaking at the Oregon State Small Farmers Conference too. So there, it's totally possible that I could be speaking in your area soon. All right. So Michelle, Renee, and Marlene, I'm going to get back to what I said to you. So the first thing you're going to start off with is thank you for being a part of our farm community. Now, Marlene, this is for you. This is really important. I wanted to know what you sold. So I clicked on your name in the Facebook group, and I can't even tell from your personal profile that you have a farm. Okay. And you don't have your website up yet, but I want everybody in this group on your personal profiles, I want you to go in and edit it. And I want you to create a job title, or it allows you to have something in there. I can't remember what it is. And it says like worked at, and I want you to put, if you don't even have a farm name, just like I'm looking at Becky's name right here. So if Becky didn't have a website or farm name or anything, it would say works at fresh cut flowers or something. Cause Marlene, when someone lands on your personal account and they're a friend of yours, you're missing out on letting them know you're even developing a business by not having that in there. So everyone in this group should have their personal Facebook profile mention their farm name, if possible, a link to their website, or just the fact that I sell raw milk, I sell grass-fed beef, I sell pastured poultry, whatever it is. So that's a tip for everybody. Make sure your Facebook profile says that you are a farmer with a business, okay? Because you're missing out on some marketing there. All right, now to continue on with Michelle, Renee. So you want to tell them you're part of the community, maybe do a short intro, that first email, since it's your very first email. But what's more important is that you tell them how you help people. So why do people buy what you sell, Michelle and Marlene? Why do they buy what you sell? It's not your farming practices. They have some problem or struggle, or they're trying to reach a goal in life. What is that? And that's what you're talking about in that first email. You're saying something like, I'm so happy to have you in our farm community. You may or may not know, we're a pastured poultry farm, and we help people who are struggling to find real food. We put them in touch with the food that is healing their leaky guts, or food that tastes like grandma used to raise and cook for us, or something like that. So you're talking to them about how your products help people. The way you learn how your products help people is you talk to some people about why they buy what you sell. If you don't sell your product yet, if you're starting next spring, you talk to people who, why do you buy farm fresh products? And if you have a chance to see me in person, I do this interview on stage and it blows farmers' minds away. So when you start listening to people about why they buy your products or others like them, they will tell you how you're helping them. And then that's what your first email says, okay? And just know that you can't say things like we heal disease, of course, because the FDA won't allow you to do that. But people are buying your products to make the most memorable Thanksgiving dinner ever, or they want to impress their friends because they love to entertain. What is that you're helping them with? That's what you put in your email, because that's why they're going to buy from you. All right. And know that in our marketing course, you learn that firsthand. Oh yeah. So Serena says, I use farm family in our welcome email. That's a perfect verbiage to use, farm family, or our farm's community, or farm family. Either one of those would be great. All right. Now, so we got through Michelle and Marlene. Dina says, is insurance needed? If so, where do I go to get the insurance? And she sells goat milk soap and possibly a milk share. So liability insurance on a milk share in California, I don't think that's possible unless you're grade A certified. I don't know of any herd shares who are able to find liability insurance anywhere. So it would be nice to have it, but I don't know if that's possible. If some No one has yet to tell me they've been able to find it. So it's a real problem in the raw milk world. So just know that in California, you probably can't find it. And then, so then insurance about the goat milk soap business, I'm guessing you're very, very, very small. So you probably don't need insurance yet, if at all, but it depends on your level of comfort. I'm a person who likes to be overinsured because as my husband and I age, we don't want to lose our retirement we've worked so hard for in a lawsuit. So we tend to have, we have insurance for our farm camp. We have separate liability insurance. We have product liability insurance, and we have home classes insurance for people who come in our house to take a class. How many insurances, you know, I'm one of those people just because my husband just turned 60 and we want to retire and we don't want to be in a lawsuit before then. But if you're under 40, maybe you don't care. So, you got to have workers' comp if you have employees. But anyway, just know that if you're really tiny, just starting out, you insurance shouldn't be a problem. But maybe liability insurance in a soap business when you get to be making $20,000 income, something like that. Before that is probably not needed, but go with your own comfort level. Like I said, I like to be overinsured. Other people, when I was younger, it didn't matter so much. So go with what works for you. Then Dina, you said, what marketing strategies could I use to be successful? I'm just going to say it again because I get asked this all the time. Email marketing with your website is the foundation that works in today's world. Once those are making you lots of sales and lots of money, then you can branch out to other channels like Facebook and Instagram or even Craigslist or wherever, LinkedIn, you know, all these Pinterest. But know that none of those channels will work until your website and email marketing is up and running. And I have free email marketing courses, free website classes for the basics. And then in order to build your profitable farm, you need to take farm marketing from the heart. Like I've said, I don't know any other marketing course that will teach you that better, or I would recommend that because it's a lot of work to teach a class. So if there was someone else doing it better, I'd say go take it from them. But you will learn step by step how to do it in that class. So be sure to budget for that, both time and finances. It's cheap because there's a sense of urgency, so you don't go out of business first, okay? All right, Shannon, Elizabeth. So how do I figure out the right moment to transition from off-farm job to full-time farmer? Because working full-time farming and taking care of small humans is a lot. Yes, it is. And I'm feeling like I can't be great at anything when I'm pulled in all these different directions. So true. You need to focus. Joel Salatin says, have a year's worth of living expenses set aside before you quit your job. I think that's a good rule of thumb, because if there's one thing everyone who's watching this video knows, farming is a very expensive business to start up and then to run. It's very expensive. So you have to have all the money to set it up and run it. And then if you're going to quit your day job, you've got to have money for health insurance and all those other things set aside too. So I'm not going to make a difference. I think Joel gives, if anyone would know the best one, I think that's a good number. But if I totally had the magic number, I would let you know. But maybe you can move to part-time, Shannon, Elizabeth. Can you, you said off-farm job to full-time farmer. Can you gradually shift to part-time or shift careers? So you take a part-time job somewhere else. You know what? Serena, who's on here right now, drives school bus. And so she's working in the morning and then the afternoon, and she does her farming in between. So maybe you can find a job that works better with your farming schedule until you can have that year's worth of living expenses set aside. You know, that includes, you got to be able to make the mortgage payment or the rent payment, whatever that is, for a year. So get all that money set aside before you quit your day job. I've just seen a lot of people quit their day jobs too soon. And, but I totally get it. If you've got kids, you've really got three jobs. You've got your off-farm job, your farm job, and your kids. Not many people could keep up three full-time jobs. So give yourself some grace, knowing that you've taken on a lot, and give yourself a limited amount of time to figure this out, because it's unsustainable to go for years and years at this rate. Plus you'll miss your kids growing up years. That's what you're out doing. You're out talking with people and meeting them in person, and they are going to connect with you and want to buy from you. So just know that the people don't come to buy your product. You are your brand. They buy from you no matter what you sell, which is really great, because a lot of farmers transition products. So if you start out as one type of farmer, like start out raising pastured poultry, and you build a customer base that's based on relationship, if you had to switch from selling pastured poultry and you did a complete 180 and now you sell a vegetable CSA, they will go with you because they are buying you. All right. That's what branding is. So just know that, Robs, get out and meet people and be the best version of you you can be, and communicate how you help people, and they will buy your products. All right. And you also make soaps. Sorry, something in my eye. Soaps from your goat milk and sheep milk. How do I get my product out to sell? So create an email list and a website and get people on there, and then you email them and they come buy your product wherever it is. So just know that is the what you're going to do. And to learn how to do that step by step is going to take an investment of time on your part, and you've got a limited amount of time to get that working for you. So be sure to set some time aside to learn how to do that. All right. So now Tammy says, oh, this is a good question, you guys. I really want everyone to hear this, because so many of us do this, make this mistake. She says, I'm stuck on a farm name. It's got to fit. It's got to roll off the tongue. It's got to be historical. It's got to be poetic. Then we can start rolling with the rest. Well, what Tammy has done, being stuck on a farm name, means she's not doing anything else to get her farm going. Being stuck means you're not taking action, and creativity comes out of action. So that name will not come to Tammy until she takes action. So this is purely a mindset struggle right here, Tammy. As soon as you decide that something like, instead of saying, I'm stuck on a farm name, I can't do anything else until I figure that out, you say something to yourself like, the perfect name will come to me at the perfect time. It may be next year, it may be 5 years, it may be next week.